This is dead serious, a show about short horror stories worthy of discussion. I'm Dead Palette, and I'm reading an SCP entry, Canoodlers. Today at this moment in non-time, we're going to be taking a look at a story entitled SCP-3817. Let's get right into it. As always, links are in the description to the entry. Item number SCP-3817. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-3817 is to be contained in a standard humanoid residential chamber at site redacted. SCP-3817 is to be restrained in the event it exhibits any signs of physical violence towards itself or personnel. SCP-3817 is required to have weekly medical examinations. Any major discrepancies in physical or mental health are to be reported to acting senior medical staff on duty. So far, it seems as though we are dealing with a completely normal human being. Let's press on and figure out if this gets weird. SCP-3817 is permitted access to the following. 1. 88-key upright piano. 1. Writing desk. Stationary. That is stationary to write on, not that the desk is stationary, although I presume the writing desk is stationary. Anyway, I'm getting off track. Note, all pens and pencils given to SCP-3817 must be at least 8 millimeters in diameter. No mechanical pencils are allowed. No luxury items such as books may be issued. Upon approval of the site director. Still not sure where this is going from the containment procedures alone, so I think we should press on into the description. Description: SCP-3817 is a man of European descent, approximately 40 years of age. SCP-3817 claims to be the German composer Felix Mendelssohn from 1809 to 1847. DNA analysis confirms this claim to be true. So we have some sort of time-traveling German composer. Interesting. SCP-3817 was recovered in Leipzig, Germany, on redacted 2000 and redacted, following reports of vocal migrant who was allegedly unable to age. Investigations of visual and written records concerning the vagrant have confirmed that it has been physically about 40 years old for the past 100 and redacted years. Full body examination revealed SCP-3817 to have sustained a degree of physical damage that would likely be fatal to a non-anomalous human being. There is currently no scientific explanation to SCP-3817's continued survival despite its critical state of health. So I like it when these kinds of entries, because they're so sterile, introduce aspects from history, like this famous German composer Felix Mendelssohn. My question is, what's going to happen with him? If this German composer really did live all these years, he must be a musical goddamn wizard by this point. If he was a famous composer back then, and now he has all the knowledge of living over 100 years, almost 200 years, and acquiring all that kind of knowledge, that has to make you, like, maybe he's, like, secretly making a bunch of hits from the world, but he's a vagrant, and that is interesting that this famous German composer is homeless, or is wandering around on the German streets, and sometime in the 2000s, early 2000s, I would suppose. SCP-3817 has confirmed the damage to have been the result of multiple self-mutilation efforts in the 100 or so redacted years prior to its containment. SCP-3817 has claimed that it has no suicidal intent in its self-mutilation. It has also claimed to have experienced no symptoms of suicidal ideation in the past 100 redacted years. SCP-3817 is currently undergoing psychiatric evaluation to verify the aforementioned claims. So conventional wisdom is he would be trying to kill himself because being immortal drives you insane or something along those lines. that is the typical place that I think people would take this story, but this is immediately, as soon as it gives you that theory, going against that and saying, no, that's not the reason. So I guess we'll have to read on to figure out why he wants to inflict damage to himself. The self-inflicted damage to SCP-3817's body are as follows. Mercury poisoning, resulting in symptoms such as increased heart rate, insomnia, and frequent sensations of pins and needles. SCP-3817 has testified to regular ingestion of mercury compounds over a period of blank years in the late 19th century. Lead poisoning, resulting in conditions such as anemia and hearing loss. Further analysis has suggested that the cause of the poisoning to have been deliberate ingestion of elemental lead from around 2006. So we know now that he was brought into the Foundation sometime after 2006. And if, 2006, that was a really bad year for hip-hop, maybe he was poisoning himself. That way he would no longer have to listen to the top 40 Billboard hip-hop songs of that year. But again, that is going against my idea that he would be a musical genius. He's trying to maybe make himself not be able to hear anymore? That might be the direction they're going with this, is that he no longer wants to be a musician. Moving on down the list, cirrhosis. There you go, Brandon. Cirrhosis of the liver, caused by long-term frequent intake of alcohol. Blank percentage of its liver has been replaced by scar tissue. The degree of cirrhosis is highly likely the result of liver failure. However, SCP-3817's liver is functional, albeit at severely impaired levels. SCP-3817 also suffers from several health problems associated with cirrhosis, such as jaundice, prolonged exhaustion, and buildup of fluid in the abdominal cavity. Ugh. So that is, I guess, not necessarily trying to self-destruct in an immediate fashion, but it's self-destructing in the way that most alcoholics do over a long period of time, or a quick period of time, if you know how to drive a car. But maybe Felix here never got his license. Accumulation of scar tissue on the eardrum in both ears, leading to recurrent tinnitus. Okay, so this is confirming this. He is just done with music for some reason. Doesn't want to be able to hear anymore. Chronic ear pains and hearing loss caused by repeated perforation of the eardrum via insertion of sharp objects into the ear canal. Sounds above 80 decibels in volume are still audible to SCP-3817. However, it is effectively deaf to normal conversation. So I hope this goes down some theoretical rabbit hole of what would happen if you were a talented musician given essentially immortality. What kind of madness would that drive you to? I don't know that I can think of a logical conclusion, but whatever conclusion this story comes to, we can judge it and see whether it is plausible or implausible, believable or not. Pressing on. Numerous small areas of scar tissue on its palms, legs, abdomen, and pelvic region identified as healed sores from primary and secondary syphilis. Oh boy. It's so nice having sex in the now when we have protection for these kinds of things. And hygiene and running water. Oh man, running water. Running water is so great. I can just like take my water bottle. Like my throat's getting sore from talking all this time. No. Running water, and it's safe. It's so nice. SCP-3817 also exhibits symptoms of neurosyphilis, such as mood swings, delusions, and hallucinations. It also has been recorded displaying irrational and obsessive behavioral patterns consistent with those exhibited by sufferers of neurosyphilis. For example, SCP-3817 has been observed obsessively making lists of the ailments of well-known classical composers. It has been observed engaging in conversation with what it claims to be the spirits of deceased composers. Investigations have concluded these spirits to be non-anomalous auditory hallucinations. So he is just like That does make sense, right? So you would go crazy and start thinking that people who were in your life at one point, your contemporaries, your fellow German composers, people that you went in circles with, you would start imagining that they were still alive. That kind of follows because everyone you know is dead, and so maybe you would start being like, pretending. You would start pretending. You might go to a childlike state and pretend that these people were still alive and that nothing has changed, along with, you know, neurosyphilis driving you up the wall and you know, that makes sense that he would have these kind of non-anomalous auditory hallucinations. So far, this seems very sensible. Overall, SCP-3817 is in poor health, and it's the old Monty Burns thing of like, sir, you have so many diseases, and they're all trying to get through this door, and it's like, so I'm very healthy. It's like, no, you are incredibly, incredibly sick. They're all balancing each other out. Overall, SCP-3817 is in poor health and reports frequent physical pain and emotional distress. Despite its current state of health, SCP-3817 has not made any of the expected requests for termination and has explicitly stated that it does not desire humanitarian euthanasia. So he does not want the Jack Kevorkian treatment. SCP-3817's maintained claim that it lacks suicidal desire has led to speculation that the cause of its biological immortality may be linked to its self-mutilation. So it is perhaps trying to self... It believes that the mutilation is giving it immortality. He believes that maybe by avoiding certain sounds, that is letting him continue to live, I suppose? But it does seem as though he was considering suicide a long, long, long time ago, perhaps when he was actually around the age of 40, because of how the Esser and early part is kind of written. It kind of insinuates that he at one point was thinking about that, but that thought long, long went away. SCP-3817 Upon the Foundation's request, SCP-3817 has agreed to provide a written outline of the reasons behind its self-mutilation for further investigation of its anomalous properties. All right, here's the money shot. I'm going to give my very best German impression. I understand that you wish to know why I have chosen this course of action. My thoughts are unclear and half wild, but I will try to organize them and explain myself to the best of my abilities. And then it says three lines of script, densely scribbled over, completely illegible. And so this next line is crossed out. It has been brought to my attention that the great composers, and that's crossed out for some reason, Beethoven cramped and vomited and lived in a world of painful silence. Mozart was sickly and misguided and miserable, and up to his powdered wig in debt. Chopin was endlessly coughing his lungs and his soul out. Schumann saw angels and demons and phantoms and had moods that were as stormy as the literature of his era. These men were great composers. They knew how it was like to be exhilarated. They knew how it was like to be in the depths of despair. They knew emotions. Their music changed and shifted and developed and grew with the changes in their lives. All of this is very worldly. This sounds like a person who has lived for a very long time and has a lot of wisdom to what they're saying and is trying to put a lot of gravity and give concrete examples that can be cross-referenced through history. All the great composers endured pain and suffering to fulfill their desire to create, and the result of their effort, timeless masterpieces. As for me, happy and fortunate is my first name. I was born into a wealthy family, showered with support and praise and money for my entire life. Never did I have to struggle to write music. No other composer experienced such profound insulation from hardship. I never understood genuine misery and misfortune. For the 38 years in which I lived, my music never changed in style or quality, and there is no doubt in my pitiful, comfortable existence impeded my artistic development. Okay, my theory was completely backwards. He is trying to inflict hardship to get better music, not the other way around. He's not trying to avoid greatness by making himself deaf. He's trying to give himself those hardships. He gave himself, well, you can't give yourself syphilis, but you can engage in actions that will earn you syphilis very quickly. Just go visit your local lot lizard. But he's dealing with a very realistic problem that goes through an artist's mind, and you deal with this like, well, you don't want to be Thomas Kincaid, right? You don't want to be the saccharine artist, and he's trying to get away from that. If anyone is a history buff when it comes to music, a musical history buff, and can tell me if Felix Mendelssohn was a very poppy artist of the time, that that information in the comments would be very helpful. I, however, am musically illiterate. And do you agree with me that the first condition of artists should be to bear respect towards what is great and how to bow to it and acknowledge it? So that's very much so the mindset of the time, that this music is to empower a greater good, a higher power, not just religion. There's like, you know, songs like Ode to Joy and concepts like that. Like, you know what's awesome? Good things. Owing to that, I have decided that I must acquaint myself with the suffering for my own sake. I must never perish. I must endure torment. I must destroy my hearing so that I would never again experience the pleasure of sound, just like Beethoven, who went deaf. Many of my illustrious predecessors, such as Schubert, Schumann, and Donizetti, suffered from syphilis, so I did what was needed. I banged a lot lizard. I did many of the, so did many of them praise alcohol and become drunkards. So I faithfully followed in their practice of drinking excessively, only ceasing when every part of my body cried, stop, no more. I like the idea of an immortal German composer going to a bar and just being like, shots, 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 shots. I took to living on the streets as a penniless vagrant so that I could worry about money, about my safety, about where my next meal was going to come from. And many illustrious composers led their lives in debt or poverty. Mozart and Wagner come to mind. There were more, and I have written them down if I could recall them. My memory is regrettably patchy. Okay, so that also makes sense. The vagrancy was not self-imposed. This man should be a musical genius, should be able to make a way in the world no matter what, but decided to live on the streets purposefully. So that explains that plot hole in my mind. Not necessarily a plot hole. It was an outstanding question that I had going into this. However, I can say with confidence that I have made significant progress since. I am always in pain. That part is crossed out. I am in constant pain, and then this part's crossed out, I can't even walk a few steps without feeling strange or numb or hurt, and I can't put it into words. That's all crossed out. I do not wish to end this pain. I wish to continue living. This is what great composers endure every day. This is what shaped and grew them, and I too must let it be an unavoidable part of my life. They have told me this. They have told me I must not give up in trying to develop myself. I have since grown accustomed to the pain in an enduring musical way. Now the following part is crossed out. I understand mankind's greatest sorrows, and they are tangible. It has completely changed the way I perceive and comprehend things. This is my life now. I have emotions now, and I am no longer emotionless. I, as an artist, have never had this kind of neuroticism. I have never been bothered by the fact that I live a very blessed life and have so many great things. I have a nice family that supports me. I have a wonderful girlfriend, a cute fluffy puppy, great friends and everything. I am more than happy not having syphilis, ladies and gentlemen. And I hope you don't go the way of this artist, Felix Mendelssohn, because I've seen people be self-destructive because of that. They're like, well, I need alcohol in my life. That way I have some sort of sorrow. It's weird. I believe I have made great leaps in terms of progress. The heavenly spirits of late composers are agreeing with me. I can hear them speak, feel their presence. They are giving me their approval. My time, I am sure, is right now. Okay, so he's having these auditory hallucinations that are manifesting, and I think this is a theory, but I think this is pretty concrete. They're manifesting because those are the voices that he himself feels. None of these composers told him to do these things, but he sees them as great, and so he is putting these words into their mouths, even though they're dead. The following is crossed out on the page. I have been writing at great speed, and then the rest is not. A volume of songs without words is nearing completion, and I am sure it is not too much to hope that, and then this is crossed out, it will satisfy the public as much as it satisfies me, will fulfill, it will be to the public's liking it, and then the rest is just illegible, scribbled over script for the rest of the note. P.S. Please forgive me for the cancellation and clumsy writing. I was weary. A poet in me was lost. I offer my sincerest apologies. And here we have a little addendum at the end. Writing the period, during the period of its stay at the Foundation, SCP-3817 has written a collection of piano pieces titled Songs Without Words. Museologists have been tasked to analyze these pieces and compare them to Songs Without Words written by Mendelssohn from 1829 to 1845. No stylistic differences have been detected. So this is the case that a lot of artists do to themselves. They drive them up the wall, and what we are finding here from this museologist is that this art, these pieces that have been composed on the piano are identifiable in styling to the old ones, and there's no change in quality. So it's like you're obsessing over this thing over and over again, trying to like make it perfect when most people can't tell the difference. It's just this thing that you've got in your own mind. So this is a really fun, cool, cautionary tale of an SCP entry. I greatly enjoyed SCP-3817. Let me know what you think down below in the comments section. Yeah.
Now, if you enjoyed that, consider helping out the community and supporting my channel. You can support the community by conversing in the comments below, going to creativehorror.com, that's creativehorror.com, for a whole host of horror-based podcasts specifically for artists, writers, and anyone creative. You can support me by subscribing to the channel, following me on social media, links down in the description, and pledging to my Patreon, which is also down below. Thank you so much for your time, and now on to our sponsor at this non-moment in time.
My umbrella. My umbrella. You can stand under it.